Hello and welcome. Today, we're diving into visual scripting's math functions. But don't worry, it's nothing like the abstract math from school. In this visual space, math comes alive, animating characters, moving objects, and determining game outcomes. Join me as we see how the fundamentals of math can truly transform your gaming projects. To get started, simply right-click in your visual scripting editor and navigate to the math category in the node menu. Here, you'll uncover a variety of math nodes, each tailored for different tasks and calculations. Some of the nodes you'll uncover are the add node, the subtract node, the multiply node, and the divide node. These nodes will be essential tools for various scenarios. Math for score. One common use is to set up a score logic, which can increase and decrease the score based on the player's actions. In the Ladybug Scroller game template, this is how the scoreboard is set up. An if node checks a condition, whether the player has successfully passed an obstacle. This is determined by the passed obstacle flag, a variable that's either true or false. If the condition is true, the flow moves to the add node. Here, the add node takes the current game score and adds the value by 1 and returns their sum. The output of the add node, the new score, is fed into a set game score node. This updates the game score variable with the new value. As players overcome each obstacle, their score climbs incrementally by 1. To display this dynamic score, you typically link the game score variable to a visual element on the screen, such as a text node or another suitable UI component. Additionally, this scoring setup can be extended to include conditions for winning, reaching a target score, or game termination. Remember, the concept of variables is central here, serving as flexible containers for data like the current score or game states, enabling a responsive and interactive gaming experience. Math for timer. Another common use of math is to set up a timer for playing your effects. In the slide puzzle template, there's a graph that demonstrates how to establish a timer using simple math nodes. Let's take a look. To make a game timer, search for the timer in your visual scripting editor and you'll see an update timer subgraph. Here's how it works. An update node begins the process by checking if the game has ended, using the Boolean variable called gameComplete. If the game is still going, false for the game completion check, the script updates the timer display. Double-click on the update timer subgraph to open it. You'll find a node called getTime. The getTime node is important because it gets the current time from when the game started in seconds. The timer works by using the mod and divide nodes to change the total seconds into minutes and seconds, so it shows like 0, 1. The mod node works out the current seconds count by dividing the total seconds by 60 and finding the remainder. The floor node rounds down any parts of a second to make sure the seconds are whole numbers. This means 1.5 seconds shows as 1 second, and 2.7 seconds shows as 2 seconds, which is easier to understand. The divide node works out the whole minutes by dividing the total seconds by 60. The floor node makes sure this number is a whole number, which keeps the timer clear and easy to read. The script uses if nodes to examine the minutes and seconds. If the seconds are less than 10, it adds a 0 before the second count. The same logic is applied to minutes. Finally, combining strings. The correctly formatted minutes and seconds are converted into a string type first. This is because the timer UI is a text object, which only allows string data. After converting it into string time, they are then joined using the append strings node to create the minute second format. This merged string is displayed as the timer on the UI using set text nodes. This way, The timer shows the game time that has passed in a minute-second format, even when minutes or seconds are single digits. End condition. To stop the timer, we use a greater or equal node to check if a certain time, in this example, 6,000 seconds, has been reached. This condition could terminate the timer. This setup generates a dynamic timer display that updates in real time, showing the game duration in minutes and seconds. It also triggers events based on the elapsed time. Math for moving, scaling, and rotating objects. In 3D space, an object's location is pinpointed by a vector 3. This is just a fancy term for a set of three numbers, x, y, and z. These coordinates tell us exactly where the object stands in the virtual world. Similarly, in 2D space, it's all about x and y. Just two values, but they still paint a complete picture of where our object is on a flat plane. Now, let's make it fun. Rather than getting into complicated math, I'll show you how we can use a random node to create lively movements with vectors. Open the template emoji ball drop. It's a demo where users open their mouths and random emojis drop. Locate the subgraph called Setup Random Position for each ball. Here's how to set up the random positions. We begin with a base position, utilizing the user's head as a reference point. This serves as the starting position for our ball, as determined by the GetPosition node. For horizontal movement, left or right, we use a random node to determine the ball's position in this scene. This node adjusts the ball's position on the x-axis, left or right, within a range from negative 1 to 1. For vertical movement up or down, a second random node is used for the y-axis, determining the ball's height within a range from 40 to negative 100. For forward or backward movement, another random node controls the ball's position on the z-axis, within a range from 0 to 1. This allows the ball to appear closer or further away. Combining the x, y, and z values, the combined VEC3 node merges the random x, y, and z coordinates into a single point, signifying the ball's new location. Lastly, the setTransform node is used to update the ball's position. If necessary, this node can also alter the object's rotation and scale. By following these steps, balls appear in unexpected places in the scene, starting from the user's head position. This adds an element of surprise and makes games or effects more engaging by constantly changing where objects appear. Math for animation. For smoother transitions and animations, consider using math nodes such as Lerp. The Lerp node can effectively refine transitions. In this given example, which is our tournament bracket template, a Lerp node is used to transition the border color of the image from white to green over 4 seconds. Here, the start value is white and the stop value is green. The step value specifies the output color between the two, where 0.5 would result in a light green. Selecting appropriate mathematical functions for animations can significantly enhance your effect quality. Here's a simple guide to using math functions in visual scripting. We learned how to use math nodes for scoreboards, timers, moving things, and determining game outcomes. We also made animations and controlled objects in Effect House using math to make them smoother and more lively. This is just the beginning. Using math in visual scripting gives you great control over your effects. So, keep exploring and creating. It will get easier with time. Visual scripting is like learning a new language. It involves connecting nodes to create the desired effect. The key to getting better? Practice, curiosity, and trying new things. That's it for this series, but there's more coming up. We'll have more visual scripting guides soon. Until then, keep creating. Your next project awaits. Thanks for coming with us on the visual scripting adventure. We're excited to see what you'll create next. See you in the next course.